Pat Buckley is an interesting character. What he doesn't realise is that if you become a bishop, you're not supposed to expose sexual abuse. You're supposed to cover it up. And Pat seems to have been exposing things that he shouldn't have. He's come from the Palmerian side of the Christian church. Pat Buckley is a proper Catholic priest. The way that he was made a bishop has been done in a particular way that the Catholic Church doesn't like.
People mistakenly think that the Catholic Church has learned its lessons on abuse and the cover-up of abuse. But it's a total lie. One of the things that illustrates that is that every diocese and every bishop and every religious order now have their own safeguarding officer.
This is what makes me laugh. The safeguarding people aren't there. The safeguarding officer isn't there to protect the children. The safeguarding officer is there to protect the church. So going back to Brass Eye, where it's sort of a paedophile disguised as a school.
We're after your help too. Security footage of a paedophile disguised as a school. He's been getting away with it in Sheffield for 12 years. Do you know him? Have you seen him? Please call.
It's a Catholic Church protection officer disguised as a child protection officer. And you can sort of almost imagine, you know, ringing the school and sort of saying, you know, so-and-so is being abused, and the child protection officer saying,
it wasn't me.
I even had her in the shower.
It wasn't me.
She even caught me on camera.
It wasn't me.
She saw the marks on my shoulder.
It wasn't me.
Heard the words that I told her.
It wasn't me.
He didn't do it. No, he didn't do it. And the officer is, of course, being employed by the church. And the church, you know, if you're employed by someone, you don't want to lose your job. Yeah. So these people aren't there to safeguard children. These people are there to manage the abuse problem from getting too big. And so the first thing they do is talk about forgiveness. Then they'll meet the parents. And then when it comes to suing, then what they'll do is they'll try to protect the school. The child protection officers employed by the schools are not there for the children. They're there to protect the business, because people just need to get their brain around the fact the Catholic Church is a business. It's an enterprise. It's got a bank. You know, since when did a spirituality have a bank? You know, Jesus didn't have a bank. You know, God didn't have a bank. The Holy Spirit doesn't have a bank. Virgin Mary doesn't have a bank. Yeah. The only group of people that have a bank that aren't a business are men, and it's called a sperm bank.
The priests of the present are predominantly homosexual. Now, in Ireland, for instance...
When you say they're homosexual, are you saying that they're out, gay men?
No, they're active, but not out.
It's like a cult of closeted gay men. I mean, monasteries and the Vatican.
Yeah.
Is that a fair... Is that an oversimplification, or...?
Especially nowadays.
You've got a group of men whose sexual persuasion for many thousands or hundreds of years has been attacked. These gay people, or gay people in general, like Oscar Wilde, they've been put into prison, they've been destroyed, reputations destroyed, and we as the public have lost. I mean, losing Oscar Wilde, the importance of being earnest, Dorian Gray, we by putting him into prison, we destroyed a large part of English writing. What do you think is going to happen if you get this band of men, this band of brothers, and you say, right, you people are dirty, disgusting, you're against God, you're against this, you're against that, we're going to kill you, we're going to cut you up, we're going to banish you. What these guys have done is they've gone, right, we need to survive. So where are they going? Well, they're going into the church and they're going into the monasteries. And what's happening is that they can't come out, they've got to live a lie, and it's turning into a perversion. A lot of these people are gay, they need to come out, and because of the suppression, because you've got to think that sexual energy is energy. If you stop water, water always finds another way to come out. And if you completely stop something like water from moving, it will burst, it will destroy something, because the pressure will build up, and sexual energy isn't any different. So if you tell someone that their energy is dirty and what they're doing is dirty, and you ban them and exile them to a place, there's going to be a resentment that's built up against society. And so what's happened is you've got these hiding places where people are shunned by society or feel guilty or told that they're bad. And then they can go to those places and hide. And what they've done is they've managed to get the society to love them again. So what the society, what would the society would have judged them to be had they been outside the monastery, they then become something which is loved when it's inside the monastery. And the people, I suppose the monks, they can get their revenge back. They can get money off these people, and they can, and the people, the society who hate them, pay for a comfortable life in the past for them to have carried out their lives. So in effect, the monastery is sort of like a self-imposed prison in the past, where the public pay the monks and monasteries money to keep these homosexuals inside the monastery because those people feel that they can't go anywhere else.
No later than yesterday on my blog, I said to such a priest who had had a bad time from his archbishop, why didn't you tell him to fuck off? And his reply was, because he pays my wages.
Here is a fantastic example of a priest who is worried about losing his job instead of doing the right thing. You know, when you're a Catholic or a Christian, that's the whole point. You're supposed to do the right thing when you're faced with challenges. That's what Joan of Arc was about. That's what Jesus was about. Aren't those the type of things that they're supposed to be trying to download into you, your guys' brains in the monastery? Aren't they supposed to try to make you guys into martyrs, to die for the right thing? Yet you've got like these young little priests that will bend towards whatever the archbishop wants because they're scared of losing their job. Ah, I'm not going to say anything that, you know, this priest is doing bad to this child because I'm scared I'm going to have my credit card taken away. And you can see how the control in the church is starting to work like a web. Yeah, the church has control over your life. You don't have any independence. You've given up your independence. You've given up your money. And also the other thing is you don't have any skills. If you go from school straight into the monastery, what skill do you have? Or you go from university into the monastery, you might have a degree, but you've got very little life experience. So if you want to go outside the monastery, where are you going to start again? So you're sort of at a real loss. You're sort of in a very vulnerable situation. And then if the archbishop is coming along, and remember the archbishops and the people of power, the clergy of power, they're there to protect the church. They're not there to protect the teachings of the church. They're there to protect the church because the church is a business. If you want anyone to protect the teachings of the church, then you need to listen or look for someone that doesn't have any affiliation with an organization which wishes to cover up sexual abuse, which is completely against the teachings of the church. And as I said before in this video, the teachings of the church go out of the door when the lawyers come in. Jesus goes out, the lawyers come in. For the church, Jesus and the lawyers are interchangeable entities that they choose whenever it suits them. And so you've got these archbishops and these very powerful people in a hierarchical position, which are controlling the other people through money and putting fear into people that if you do not abide by the general narrative, then we will punish you.
You see, one of the big things, I don't know whether you've ever thought about this, is priests in the past and the church in the past, they didn't think of abuse as a crime. They thought of it as a sin.
The Catholic Church doesn't really have a lot of different descriptions for different types of sexual sin. So for instance, let's say you've got groping, touching, penetration, kissing, fondling, exposing yourself, cheating, being gay, having alternate sexualities. The Catholic Church just has sort of one united thing that it puts, well, basket for all of them, and it's just called sexual sin. So if you go as a priest and have sex with an adult, then you've committed a sin. And if you go and rape a child, you've committed a sin. And the two sins are sort of seen as the same thing. I think it's only until quite recently that there has been some sort of defining on the different types of sin. And it's got something to do with canon law, and I can't remember what it is. And that's one of the issues. So when the Catholic Church goes, oh, okay, yeah, he's been raped, has he? Oh, God, that's terrible. 50 times he's been raped, has he? Poor child. You know, they're sort of thinking that it's like a legitimate relationship with a grown woman.
I get hate mail every single day of my life.
That's awful.
When I turn on my blog in the morning,
yeah,
I get at least 10 messages of absolute hate.
Do you know who they're from?
Generally, I suspect they're from priests.
And what do they say?
Well, do you know I have HIV? Did you read that?
No, I didn't.
But priests call me every night an AIDS-ridden fucker.
That's so hateful.
So let me get this right. Here's a bloke who's a bishop that's uncovering crimes, who's exposing sexual abuse, and the people that are inside the system that are doing that are calling him and calling him dirty words and nasty things. And here we can see the people that we're supposed to be following in the society, the priests, they're the problem. If you've got priests which are trying to stop other priests from exposing things which are bad in order to protect children, because all the priests are interested in doing is trying to protect an institution, and that institution has got absolutely nothing to do with God or Christianity or Jesus. Because if you've got something to do with something, it's not in name, it's in behavior. You can't judge everything by words. You can't judge everything by suits. You can't judge everything by titles. You can't judge everything by a facade. And that's where Pat Buckley seems to be a bit different. He's actually putting his head on the line. He's actually saying things that no one wants him to say. He's saying things that priests should be saying. And what's happening is that whenever you stick your head out to do the right thing, whenever you come up against something like sexual abuse, whenever you come up against something which is trying to destroy the fabric of society and control the fabric of society through sexual abuse, you're going to get hate. But you don't expect it to be from the priests. And here we have a very, very, very important example of how the Catholic Church manages itself and what type of people are in the Catholic Church that you go to and pray, believe in, and allow bits of bread to be put in your mouth by them. Quite frankly, I wouldn't let a priest put anything in my mouth. If you want to listen to the full podcast, you can go to the links below and you can go to Podbean and you can listen to everything from Andrew Taylor's Podbean website.